K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we're expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at advertise@k98talk.org. The leader in talk radio on the internet, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't gonna be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Lord.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
They say we offer simple answers to complex problems. Well, perhaps there is a simple answer. Not an easy answer, but simple.
It's common ground. It's common ground. It's common ground. It's common ground.
We have serious problems to solve, and we need serious people to solve them.
Republicans and Democrats.
All right, folks, it's Saturday morning, and you know what that means. It's time for Finding Common Ground. Now, this is a bit of a special episode. For the moment, I have my co-host on mute so I can torment him. I won't play more than 30 seconds of it because we are currently being reviewed by Harp. But it was his birthday yesterday, so here we go, folks. That's right, folks. Bryce's birthday was yesterday. This is apparently supposed to be the Minions trying to sing Happy Birthday. It's not working out yet, though. Oh, there we go. Remarkably, their version of Happy Birthday sounds like Mama Ran. Okay, I think that's enough of that. Alright, I guess I'll be nice and bring you off a mute now, Bryce.
Alright. Well, thank you very much.
You are welcome. I guess I should have listened to that before I played it. I figured it said Minions Happy Birthday, so they were just going to do their little stumbly bumbly impersonation while actually using the right song. And yeah, they didn't, so whatever. Yay! All right, so anyway, how was your birthday?
It was really good. I got to go out to dinner with my friends and family. I got to take a test on government and politics when I went to school, and I got my license, which was always a good thing.
Wait, you got your license?
Yep. In New Jersey, we get it kind of late. We get it at 17.
I'm just thinking I'm glad you're in Jersey and I'm in Oklahoma. I don't want to keep having to jump off of the sidewalks to keep from getting run over.
Well, you know.
Notice I said off the sidewalks.
Yeah, I heard that part. But for you, I might be coming for you, not doing it by accident. You know, you say something about Bernie Sanders and then I might run you over.
Oh, so if I say something about Bernie, it's on? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, basically.
That's all right. Just remember that when I give you your homework.
Oh. Yeah, for anyone who doesn't know, Rick is my new teacher in school. So,
yes, yeah, I am now a school teacher in New Jersey. How flippin' scary is that?
Oh, God. Yes, Mr. Rowdy Robinson.
Oh, my word. I have to admit, that is an interesting concept. They don't have anything like that around here. I kind of wish they did, though.
Yeah, it's supposed to be an independent internship program. So I presented it to my principal, and they were like, cool, who's your mentor? So, obviously, it was K98's own Rowdy Rick Robinson, and now he is my teacher.
Now, go paint my fence. Oh, wait, I forgot. It's not Mr. Miyagi style. Never mind.
I was about to say, I'd rather wax your car.
Wax, oh, never mind. We're just not even going to go there. It's too early in the morning. I have no filter. Okay, so we have...
Oh, God.
I told you.
All right, the Iran deal, everybody.
All right, so yeah, the Iran deal. We might as well start there. There's a long list of people I would like to basically see drummed out of office thanks to this latest round of the Iran deal, some of which are actually supposed to be conservatives. They don't necessarily fit the bill any longer and haven't for a while, and it shows in their voting styles, aka two prominent names that stick out the most are Lindsey Milquetoast Graham and John, I used to be a Maverick, but now I'm McRhino McCain.
Absolutely. I mean, Lindsey Graham, I always thought sounds weird. I mean, but other than that, I don't see him as a real...
I could say what Lindsey Graham sounds like to me, but I would probably offend someone.
Yeah, that's why I'm trying to hold back on this one.
Let's just say I think he needs some WD-40 for the hinges and leave it at that.
Okay, yeah, fair enough. but no, I mean, you know what the thing is? I know John Oliver did a whole skit about it where he says, you know, it's called the Iran deal. A deal implies that you don't get what you want, because they were playing a bunch of clips from politicians saying how we need a better deal. This is not a good deal. We need a better deal. So he was saying, Joe, like, oh, yeah, let's just go get a better deal. And while we're at it, let's go get a greater deal. But here's the thing. With this Iran deal, it's just blatantly not a good deal at all. So don't take the deal. No deal. Right? That's the whole show. Deal or no deal.
Yeah, I know. I feel like we should have Howie Mandel in the background going, deal or no deal?
That would be perfect.
Because, but the thing about this is, and you know, a deal is a single syllable word. Another word that describes what a deal is actually more aptly is a compromise. You know, where basically each side is giving up things to get to the point where everybody gets to the middle to get something that each of them wants. This is not a deal. This is we're handing them the farm, the cow, and the keys to the Buick all at the same time, and we're just like, here, take it. We don't care. Yeah, we'll give you whatever you want. Here, just. And I don't even know why we're doing it, to be honest, because it's not like, I mean, The only thing I can think of, and this is going to be my tinfoil hat moment for the day, but think about this for a second, because Valerie Jarrett has been in the White House now as basically an admin to the president for, what, 7-ish years? And she's from there? I'm wondering if her mission in life has been to dig up as much dirt as possible on this man, so if he ever got to the point where he was where he is now, she could hold it all over his head, or over his head, to get everything that she wanted for her country. And I know, I'm taking my tinfoil hat back off now, but that's just my random thought of the day. Because this deal makes absolutely no sense to me. It's not like even Iran is coming at it from a point of strength, because they don't have any. And honestly, from what I'm hearing in the news, this deal is about to become worthless anyway, because now a lot of the states are stepping up and increasing their sanctions, Texas being one of them, and a few others are following suit. So, I mean, I don't even know if it's going to wind up being worth the paper it's printed on by the time it's done. And honestly, from what I'm hearing from the Iranian government themselves, I really hope it's not, because they're already basically telling us, hey, yeah, go ahead, give us whatever you want. We're still going to take all of this money that you're about to free up for us and go put it right over here in the hands of all these people that you don't like, because we're still hoping to eventually wipe you and Israel off the map. Okay, thanks for playing. Have a great day. Goodbye.
You know, here's my theory on this, though. It's exactly what you love. When you have an enemy, become economic best friends with them. Because guess who's going to start producing a lot of oil and sending it all to the United States and to Europe? Iran. They're going to be flooding the market with more oil. Oil prices will get cheaper than they already are. And we're going to have a new economic partner. I think this is more strategic than it is, you know, based off our nuclear safety. Is strategic for the future, because think about it this way. I don't think this is a Republican or Democrat idea. I think this is just a blatant understanding that oil is not going to last forever. There is this thing called what's his name? Something M. King Hubert. Hubert, something like that. He worked for the Shell Oil Company, and he predicted that in the 1970s we would start running out of new oil locations in the United States, which it happened. We've never produced more oil since the 1970s. And now we're producing more because we're still drilling, but we're not finding any more places. So ultimately, the world eventually is going to run out of new reserves for oil. But guess where there is still a lot of oil, because we haven't talked to them in a while? Oh, our buddies in Iran. So we're going to open their door up, continue to the flow of cheap oil, while our economy can get ready for the collapse of oil. That's my take at it. But that might be my tinfoil hat moment, too.
Yeah, I mean, the thing about that is, even if that is the overall goal, is to try to bring more oil into the market, at this point, what they're going to wind up doing, and this is already... My state is already starting to feel the impact, because Oklahoma, Texas, North Dakota, those are all places where oil is the main push of the economy. There, and in my day job, I talk to people all day, every day, who are being laid off from their oil jobs. So the thing about that is, if that really is their idea, is to get as much oil into the open market as they can, they're doing it the wrong way, because they're going to want – I mean, think about it this way. Texas and North Dakota have been where the majority of the job growth has been during the Obama presidency. And why has that been? Because of the oil. Because there have been companies that are going out there. They're going after it. So if we all of a sudden flood the market with new oil, all we're doing is killing the two biggest job creation states that we have right now, which is ultimately going to cripple the economy. So if it is what they're doing, and you might be right, I think they might be doing it for another reason, because let's not forget that Obama has told everybody from the beginning his ideal as a president was to get everybody in the world on the same level at the same time. And we've tried it for over 100 years now at this point to build up the rest of the world around us. But what a lot of the folks that Obama has learned from figured out along the way is it's a lot easier to tear things down than it is to build other things up. I'm honestly really starting to think, with everything that's going on, that they are starting to try to intentionally collapse the economy. because it will knock us down a few pegs. And then at some point, everybody's going to get the one world government they want because we won't have the ability to stop them anymore.
Hey, hey, hey. That would be interesting. But, you know, I do definitely think that the United Nations or a one world government would be a step in the right direction if we weren't all such bumbling idiots. If more countries embraced democracy, perhaps it would be a better tool, you know, to fight poverty, world hunger, stuff like that. But I don't know. I feel like it's so corrupted with money and arms dealers and oil Mongols or whatever that it's never going to work. At least now in our lifetime, as of now. But what scares me the most about the Iran deal is I feel that there are, whatever the intentions may be, whether you're right or I'm right or they're somewhere in the middle or it's somewhere completely out of left field, I don't believe that the Iran deal is to solve the problem that it's being marketed to solve. It's to do something else that is being kept in the dark. Because it doesn't make sense that if you want to keep Iran from having nuclear missiles or nuclear warheads, you allow them to continue to engage in nuclear science and nuclear activities when sanctions have been led so successfully that they came to the table, that they are a nation in economic despair because the United States has crippled their economy without firing a bullet. So we were doing something right, and now all of a sudden we are rushing to this deal. I feel like there's something that it just doesn't add up.
All right, well, we'll talk about that more after the break because, you know, it interests me the way your thought processes have changed since you started actually doing this type of stuff, and we're going to touch on that a little bit when we get back.
The internet will never be the same. You're listening to K98Talk.com.
Good God, y'all.
What is it good for?
Absolutely.
Now get started again.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
I'm easy like Sunday morning. Wondering why you're up early with us on a Sunday morning making a cocktail? News lately got you drinking? Hung over from the mainstream media by Sunday? We are, and we got you covered.
We sure do. We got your hangover cure for those weekly news blues. So sit back, top off your mimosa, and add some Baileys to that coffee.
Take a match to your copy of the New York Times. Light, funny, and oh yeah, news with booze.
And a lot of laughter.
Welcome to Bloody Marys and Broad Sheets.
I paid my dues to make it.
Wake up, America.
The biggest threat in those days were from factions seizing control of the governing apparatus and making decisions that were in their interests. Today, we call factions political parties. George Washington himself warned the nation about the dangers of factions in his farewell address.
Office hours with Dr. A, 3 p.m. on Sundays, K98 Talk. We've got something to say to you, America.
The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
Our military service members volunteer to protect us in the most dangerous places around the world. They step up. And when they are severely ill or injured, returning to their families is only the beginning of their long road home. Wounded Warrior Project provides these brave men and women whatever they need to continue their fight for independence at no cost for life. So now it's time for a grateful nation to step up. Join us at findwwp.org.
All right, folks, we're back. We're live. This is Finding Common Ground. And when we went to break, Bryce had started talking about his thoughts on the Iran deal and the fact that there's probably something more underlying than we're being told, which wouldn't surprise me because, I mean, come on, this is the same government that pays $50,000 for a toilet seat and then tells us that it's only for the toilet seat. I don't think so, Skippy. But, you know, back to what we were talking about before, because this is what intrigues me. Because when you and I had first started doing this show, when we first started talking the Iran deal, you were all for it. You thought it was a great idea. You thought it would be a good way to show the Iranian people that we're not the buttheads that their government likes to make us out to be. And then somewhere along the way, your mindset changed. So just in case, because I know we have some new listeners, why don't you go ahead and walk folks through what's changed for you?
All right. So originally, yes, I still believe an Iran deal is a great idea. We should have an Iran deal. But as the deal developed and the framework and the wording, I guess, comes out about it, and the more you read about it, you realize this is no deal. This is a bad deal. And I mean, From my perspective, an American Jewish child, I love Israel. I don't want to see Israel, you know, burned off the map. And I don't want to see America hurt because I love this country very much. So to make a deal with a country that at one point was very Western style, right? They had a democracy and we destroyed it. I mean, let's not get ourselves wrong. We are the reason Iran is so awful right now. Because in 1953, we overthrew their democratically elected parliament and implemented the Shah, who was eventually overthrown. And he was obviously an American puppet, hence why they hate America. Because we literally destroyed their democracy. So, good job, Dwight, in reference to Dwight D. Eisenhower. But here's the problem. When we want to make up for that and do this Iran deal, it still just doesn't seem like a deal that is all like, hey, let's mend our ways and try to fix things and become a peaceful, you know, relationship. That's not what it sounds like. And it sounds very scary.
Sorry, I actually was messaging somebody else, so I wasn't paying that much attention. Sorry.
Oh, okay. No big deal.
I was like, oh, wait, he's talking to me because he just stopped. Oh, no. Now I know how it feels to be on the other side of this, because normally I'll get going on a pretty good thing and then I would toss Dave a question and he's like, huh, sorry, I wasn't paying attention. I'm like, oh, okay. So now I know what it feels like to be on the other side of that. I'm sorry, because I've been where you are right now, and it was kind of an awkward moment, so I just figured I would take most of the awkwardness and throw it right on my shoulders where it belongs.
No problem.
So anyway, I mean, yeah, no, to me, it's just been interesting seeing how your mindset has changed on this. And you're right, I think a lot of it has to do with the way the deal is unfolded. But, you know, I still stand by my original idea. If the Iranian people are the ones that want this deal so badly, then they need to do something to make sure that they can get this deal. Like, get rid of the idiots that are currently running their country, and then we'll deal with them directly. until that happens, we should have continued doing what we're doing. Because the simple fact of the matter is, what we're doing is not going to be good for anybody. I mean, I know everybody's like, but look at all the oil that's going to get flooded into the market. First of all, there is this old adage that too much of a good thing is not a good thing. And if we start releasing all of the oil into the market, everybody's eventually going to go broke. So at some point, they're either going to start artificially reinflating the prices, or they're going to restrict the flow of oil anyway, because if it's too cheap, nobody makes any money off of it, and that's never going to happen. Until we can actually get to the point where we've come up with whatever our permanent alternative fuel is going to be, oil is not going to go anywhere.
And well, hang on, because that's already happening. Because, in the OPEC. OPEC is already doing that. You see, they have more oil than any of us, right? It's Saudi Arabia and Egypt and all those countries.
They're doing it for very different reasons. They want the world's economy to collapse.
Right. They want to bankrupt us and then take everything. So, I mean, in a sense, what you're saying might already be happening.
But yeah, but that's my point. All we're doing now is helping them do what they wanted to do. Because, yeah, OPEC's had the majority of the oil. So now we're about to flood even more oil into the system, and all we're going to do is drastically drop the prices. And that's why I'm saying, you know, you call it tinfoil hat moment, whatever you want to call it. If you look, and there's some clips that I want to play to bring things more to the stuff that's going on at home right now. If you look at everything that's going on in the news, from the protests to the people that are now calling for the death of white people and cops. We've got folks like Farrakhan that are basically saying, I need 10,000 strong, brave black men from the 10 million to wipe out the white race. If you tie all of this together, there's only so many things that you can look at as isolated incidents before you start putting them together and you realize it's becoming a tapestry, whether you want it to be or not. Our foreign relations stuff is geared towards doing things that are not in the best interest of our country. Our home policies, for the moment, are geared towards doing things that are not in the best interest of our country. So when are we going to wake up and realize that these idiots that we have in D.C. are no longer doing things in the best interest of we the people? Because that's exactly what's going on right now. Case in point, right here. This is from a show that airs on Blog Talk Radio, which is where all of our little fun stuff started. But it's a pretty scary clip. I actually had to go through and edit quite a bit of it, so you're going to hear lots of bleeps, but here it is anyway.
Until the police ain't there no more, and that's when we should act. When the niggas are by themselves, that's when we should start fucking like they do us. There's a bunch of them niggas taking one of us out, that's how we should roll up. Since we already rolled up in gangs anyway, find a little six or seven black, see that white person, and lynch there. Let's turn the table. I think if we start turning tables and cops start losing people, this will be a different story.
Yeah.
Then it will be a state of emergency, and there's either two things going to happen. Either we're going to have a big-ass arms war, or niggas are going to start backing up. And we're already getting killed out here, so what the we got to lose?
Yep. That's true. That's so fucking true.
We just need to turn the tables on them. Our kids are getting shot out here. Somebody needs to become a sacrifice on their side. That's just how I feel. Like I said, everybody ain't down for that shit or whatever. But like I said, everybody has a different position in war. We need to get who's down for that shit and do it. Because they don't give a fuck anyway. So we might as well utilize them for that shit and turn the tables on these niggas. So we can start looking like we ain't having that many casualties. And it'd be more casualties on their side instead of ours, because we out here killing black people. Black lives don't matter. Not to those motherfuckers, so we got to make it matter to them. But we got to start putting more black people per white people. That's what we need to find them that's alone. Snap his ass and hang him from a dick tree. Take a picture of it. Send it to motherfuckers. I bet it'll turn the whole tables on. We just need one example. One example, and people will start watching. Because it's gonna be a trickle down effect. As soon as one person gets hung, people are gonna start having an idea to do that shit some more, and it's gonna become a trickle effect. Black people are good at starting trends. I mean, we just are. So if we get one group of black people to hang one of these racist motherfuckers and let the Confederate flag You know what I'm saying? Let the Confederate flag hang right where they're hanging. This will be a different conversation. We'll be having a conversation about unity. We're having a conversation about how many more niggas gonna try to attack us, and we gonna get the upper hand. We need the upper hand.
Not just one racist motherfucker. We need to make an example out of a cop that's been killed one of us and get it off. That would be the best method
right there.
Not just one racist motherfucker out of a cop that's been killed one of us and get it off.
So that's just one clip among, I think, how many did I play Thursday? Because it was the last show that I did because I had to take last night off. I think I found 7-8 different clips, all from different sources, all basically sounding exactly the same. And then
you know
we
how
have.
How did it make me feel? Like this. Okay, I'm sorry. I just had to play that.
Really?
That's
your contribution to this conversation right now?
No. I'll get serious, but continue what you were saying.
No, I'm just playing. But anyway, so, you know, and then one other really quick one that really, I mean, not to sound like Peter Griffith, but this one really grinded my gears. Alright, so the audio, I tried to clean it up a little bit. Might still be hard to hear on the radio, not sure, but it's basically a bunch of people chanting pigs in a blanket, fry 'em like bacon. Now, would it be such a big deal if they were saying all of these things and nothing was happening? Probably not. But in the last several days, we've had several cops that have been killed. We've also had a few that have been attacked that the media is really not covering. The one that stood out to me, and I don't remember which town it was in, there was a female officer who had gotten out of her car to respond to someone who presented as a disabled vehicle. She was then badly beaten and thrown off of a bridge. We have cops that are being shot while they're pumping their gas. And we have an entire group of people that are egging that type of behavior on. That concerns me, because here's the problem, and nobody wants to take this into account. Again, it's another thing where if you start looking at it, you're going to start seeing a pattern. All of these little incidents that the media is hyping up and talking about this cop that was killed and this cop that was killed or that cop that was killed, even if it's not these people doing that, it doesn't matter. It could be some crazy white guy doing it. But the people that are calling for these type of movements are seeing those things happen. And the first thing they're thinking is, man, it's finally starting to happen. We're going to take it back to the man. And each one of those things is like a pebble being dropped in a pond. It makes a big splash at first, and then it ripples outwards. And each time one of these news stories break, there's more of a ripple effect, and each time, more of a ripple effect. And again, it doesn't matter who's doing it, because the people that want this to happen are seeing it, and they're considering it a call to action, which is why it's getting worse, not better.
All right, but, you know, here's maybe just be some food for thought, but let's just think about this. You know, at one point in our society, they were segregated. They were strategically, you know, beaten down, and they were sentenced to prison and for unjust reasons, and literally laws kept them different from people like you and I in our society. So there's a different stigma when it comes to, I guess, for them, and when it comes to us viewing the same thing, in this case, police brutality or police action. So my point is that when you're black in America, there's a history that follows it. And when you're white in America, there's another history that follows it. I must say, we need better relations between cops and between the African-American community. That's just something that it should be talked about by the police. It should be talked about in communities. Something needs to get done. Because right now, it's not very good at all, evidently. But here's the thing. I don't want to totally tear apart their movement for, you know, equal justice or whatever, because you have an idiot like the one you just played, you know, saying ridiculous things like that.
Bryce, because it's not just one idiot. Hang on, I'm not done yet.
King Noble, black supremacy. And I want to talk about the shooting of the white deputy sheriff in Houston, Texas. Reminds me of a Bob Marley song, I Shot the Sheriff. Very interesting to me with the Houston, Texas brutal execution before the public represents to me is its open season on killing whites and white police officers and probably killing cops, period. It's open season. And then you just had Straight Outta Compton come out with this fuck the police and this revisitation of this rebellious energy towards the police department and the police. So now you got some black militant or some angry black man walks up and executes a cracker cop in broad daylight. This is real. It's open season on killing white people and cops. It's unavoidable, inescapable. It's funny that now we'll move into a time where the predator will become the prey. Yes, they said there will be a race war and that we cannot win a race war. We can't win. We're outnumbered. They got weapons, they got drones, they got this, they got that. But I remind you of the buffaloes who outnumber the lions. They're bigger than lions and they move in larger herds, but they're picked off by lions one by one by one, picking them off. Today we live in a time where the white man will be picked off and there's nothing he can do about it. His day is up. His time is up. We will witness more executions and killing of white people and cops than we ever have before. We see with the Houston, Texas shooting, and we see with the news reporting shooting in Virginia. It's about to go down. It's open season on killing white people and crackers. The Black Lives Matter movement wasn't enough. We tried to appeal to them, to let them know that this type of thing would come, it would happen. They thought they were indestructible and invincible because they took advantage of the weakness of black people for too long with all this police brutality. And now they've got black men out there that just can't take it anymore. And they're willing to act out. And they're willing to get you when you least expect it. Come at you when you're not thinking about it. It's not safe no more to be white in America. Lurking behind any corner could be an angry black man ready to take your ass out. It's a reality. It's open season on killing whites and police. And they better make some serious, serious changes, social changes at this point. Because it ain't looking good. And they gonna get embarrassed. Because just when they tried to make themselves look invincible and untouchable and we got this under control, clearly there's some black people out here that's about to show you that you might not just have it like that. It's King Noble Black Supremacy. Join my website, www.kingnobleblackrulership.com.
And like I said, there are tons more where this guy came from. I played a lot of these on the show I did Thursday. There's another one that I do want to play real quick when we get back, but we have got to take the bottom of the hour break, and then we'll probably finish out the rest of the show kind of talking about this, but I don't know what else to do other than try to bring this to people's attention, because at this point, we are about to enter a time that if we don't do something to change this, it's going to become very scary around here. Because there, trust me, for every one guy that's crazy enough to pick up a video camera and put this stuff on YouTube, there's at least 10 more ready to stand behind him. And these things are starting to pop up everywhere, and that really scares me. I'm just being honest here.
The internet will never be the same.
You're listening to K98Talk.com.
Good God, y'all.
What is it good for?
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't gonna be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Laura.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
Patrol, stay on watch, on point, asking them to put themselves in harm's way, to endure it all. But we do understand that it's our turn, our duty, to bring them all the way home, to keep them secure, to have their backs for the rest of their lives. Wounded Warrior Project long-term support programs do whatever it takes to help our most severely ill or injured veterans live independently, at no cost, for life, so that they might stand at ease. Find out how you can help at findwwp.org.
All right, folks, we're back. Now, I want to play one more clip, and then I want to free up enough time where we can actually discuss some of this stuff. But, you know, this has actually been a recurring conversation for me for the last few days. You know, it's like, hey, you know, free speech, they can say whatever they want. Until you hear this next story, I would probably agree with you. But the thing is, yeah, it may be their free speech, but is it any coincidence that this type of stuff is starting to happen at the same time that folks are starting to say things like this all over social media? And we'll just let you have a listen to it right here.
They are members of a South Philadelphia neighborhood, and they assembled tonight to vent their frustrations and demand that the police help them the way they're sworn to do. They're calling for protection from four people who are causing real trouble. And those four people are women. It is Tuesday night. And the big story on Action News tonight is an impassioned demonstration tonight of neighborhood concern. Action News reporter Dan Cuellar is live at Philadelphia Police Headquarters. Dan, what are the details on this? Well, Jim, officials now say an internal affairs investigation is underway into why 3rd District officers failed to investigate racial tension said to be brewing in the South Philadelphia neighborhood. The outrage spurred a large rally tonight despite the rain.
We will no longer allow you to terrorize our neighborhood. White lives matter.
150 to 200 people spewed onto the middle of 4th and Wolf this evening to protest a rash of what they claim are racial attacks at the hands of 4 black women who live nearby.
These females have been terrorizing the neighborhood. They have robbed, attacked, and beat others in our neighborhood.
This man, who did not want to be identified, says he and his 10-year-old son were among the victims.
It was attacks sitting on my doorstep, basically for no reason at all. For what reason, I still don't know.
That quick, I seen 4 women attacking a white man.
Another woman who also did not want to be identified says the women attacked her inside her home, calling her racial epithets when she tried to intervene.
And next thing I know, I hear, white, we're going to you up. And I just went to shut my door saying, I don't even know yous. I don't even know yous. Next thing I know, they're just inside spitting on me, pounding on my face, beating me.
The victims further claim responding officers from the 3rd District did not even take a report or make any arrests. A report was finally taken after Councilman Mark Squilla got involved, and there is now an internal investigation.
We know there were several calls to 911 that day. We are reviewing those calls. It will be part of the record for the internal investigation. That'll be put on record and decided why things went down the way they did.
The captain of the 3rd District says he is looking into the complaints.
Whether it's it winds up being a training issue, then we'll retrain the officers. But if the investigation reveals something more drastic, where punitive action has to be taken, where formal discipline might have to be implemented, then that's what we'll do.
Meanwhile, a criminal complaint has been filed with the district attorney's office on the 4 women said to be involved in the attacks, but so far, no charges have been filed. Live at police headquarters, I'm Dan Cuellar, Channel 6, Action News.
Thank you, Dan.
All right, so I played that for 2 reasons. One, let that sink in for a second. There's actually now a group of 4 black women that are terrorizing a neighborhood in Philadelphia. 2, we've now gotten to the point where police are refusing to do their jobs. And why? I'll tell you why. We have now reached a point where society is turning on its protectors. It's only a matter of time before those same protectors decide to return the favor and turn on society. And we're seeing this right here, right now, being demonstrated in a single neighborhood in Philadelphia. And again, it's going to have a ripple effect, whether anybody wants to admit it or not. And like I said before, it was either before the break or right after, for every one of these crazy people that is willing to put up a video that calls for black supremacy and wiping out the white race, for every one of those people, there's at least 10 people that are willing to stand up behind them. If you don't believe me, I didn't pull them because it wouldn't translate well for the video, but you can find them on YouTube. There is an entire movement, a militarized Black Lives Matter movement, marching through the streets in full camel regalia, carrying automatic looking weaponry and shotguns and everything else, which, hey, you know what, I'm a Second Amendment kind of guy, that's fine. But the problem gets into when they're marching through the streets chanting things like oink oink bang bang and the only good pig is a dead pig. We are in real trouble, and nobody wants to talk about it, and everybody just wants to say, oh, Rick, it's just because they're so angry, and it's because they've been so mistreated. You know what? That's crap, because a couple hundred years ago, a bunch of my ancestors stood up and said, no more of this crap. These people are people, too. They're going to be treated like people, and they fought, and they bled, and they died to bring freedom to these people, and now all they're doing is basically everything that everybody that wanted them to remain slaves was afraid they were going to do from the jump, which is get control and kill everybody. So you tell me, what the hell are we supposed to do? Because now we have an entire sect of these people calling for our extermination. Are we just supposed to sit around and wring our hands and wait for them to come kill me? I'll tell you what I'm doing. I'm moving out to the country, and I'm building a fence. And that fence will have guns, and I will not be the one to shoot first. But if it goes crazy, don't come to my place. I'm just saying.
Okay. I need a minute to intervene here. Rick, there are 4 black women who are strategically beating up white people, and cops apparently weren't doing their jobs. Newsflash, that there were hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of white people who strategically killed black people, and the cops were in on it and did nothing about it then. That was called the KKK. I'm not condoning what they did, but
no,
I'm just
actually,
saying.
You kind of really just are, so.
No, but the. But come
look,
on.
Look, I'm not making excuses for the KKK. That's exactly what the hell I just said. But you are making excuses for these people. Because they were mistreated, they get to do whatever the hell they want?
Absolutely not.
That's what you just absolutely basically not. Said.
But just because we play three people talking about, you know, or three incidents where these black people are totally against white people. And yes, the Black Lives Matter.
Dude, take 30 seconds and YouTube Black Lives Matter. You're going to find more than three people doing it. You're...
We can't pretend that there aren't white people out there who are just as militant against black people than there are black people militant against white people. And then there's the majority right in the middle where we can all get along. But to assume that all these Black Lives Matter people, yeah, okay, you know what, they're vocal, all right? They're catching media attention. But that doesn't mean anything. To assume that we should all, you know, move to the country and get a gun and, you know, get ready because we're going to war with these, that's baloney. It's peanuts. It's not what's going to happen. In all honesty, what we should be doing is focusing on what is the problem. The problem is that we have a society that has been separated and kept apart for so long. And now we are all starting to, you know, at some levels embrace equality. There are some who are trying to keep us back from that. And at the same time, we want to be living in a nice society. And what's happening is we have people who want to move very quickly, people who want to move very slowly, and it's not working. We have cops who are killing black people, unarmed black men, and that looks bad because of how the media portrays it. But then on the other end, you have these same African Americans or black people, whatever, also committing crimes or whatever you want to call it.
Okay, hang on, because hang on, because at this point you're starting to cross a line again, and you're not making a very good distinction. Because the issue is, yes, bad white cops kill black people every day, but nobody talks about it when black cops kill white people. Nobody talks about the fact that these same people that are up in arms over this handful of people that I will admit probably should have never been cops, and somebody should have caught them before any of this stuff happened. But nobody talks about the fact that in their own neighborhoods, they are their own worst enemy. And now they're starting to turn that anger in another direction. And I'm telling you, you may not want to admit it, but I've seen these trends before. They've happened in places like Germany. They've happened in places all over the world, and when it happens, it may take a while, but we're nearly there, and nobody's talking about it. And I don't know if we'll get to the point where there's going to be an all-out race war, but when you get to the point where this many people, because like I said, this is only a handful of clips. Do the YouTube research on your own. Do the article research. There are hundreds of thousands of people calling for the extermination of the white race. Prominent among them is Louis Farrakhan, who can fill football-sized stadiums with an audience, calling for 10,000...
David Duke.
And am I condoning David Duke? No.
And I'm not condoning that guy. My point is, though, is that there are groups and factions of every race that are extremists. And not even races, just groups in general. There are extremist conservatives and socialists who call for the death of each other. I'm sure if you could think of it, it's there. My point is, though, to say the way it is coming off from what you're saying, it sounds like it's not extremists that are the problem, but it is this black, it's black that is the problem.
No.
And I think we've created
the problem. Don't put words in my mouth.
No, I'm saying that's how it sounds. And it sounds to me like what we're missing here is who started the problem. And I think that's the white race, the superior ones, for historical.
Oh, great. So now here we go with all the white guilt BS when we're the ones that stopped slavery in the first place. I'm tired of picking up that damn cross. We were the ones that stopped slavery. Jim Crow was instituted because people still wanted to go backwards. We still stopped it. These people have rights. They won the civil rights movement back in the 60s. It's 50 freaking years later, now almost 60 years later, and we're right back where we started because there's a bunch of angry people that have got 5 minutes of fame. And I'm telling you right now, This is not going anywhere until we fix the problem. But I don't know how to fix the problem. Because every time I turn around, there's more and more angry people on both sides. Look at what's going on with Donald Trump. Look at all the traction that he's getting because people are angry. You don't think the same thing is happening over there? So what are we supposed to do? Ban the First Amendment to calm everybody down? Because that's what somebody's going to try to do. That's my point. We are about to reach the point where the government is going to feel like they're not going to have any choice but to step in. And I'm telling you, I think it's happening by design. Look at everything they're doing. I didn't just point this out because I'm afraid all of a sudden there's going to be some black guy come kick in my door. First of all, I live in Oklahoma. We're pretty sane here. I'm more scared of folks that live in places like California because there are places that white folks can't go in California. There are places that white folks won't go in California. There are places that cops won't go in California. And I know this because I speak to them every single day. There are entire districts in California that have almost no police presence because nobody wants to go in there. And nobody wants them there. And that's the stuff that's going to start spreading. But the problem that we have is, again, we're not looking at the big picture. We're not looking at the fact that we have a government that is working outwardly with the rest of the world to collapse our economy. We're not looking at the picture that we have a president that has not been putting these racial tensions to bed, as he promised he was going to do, but stirring them up instead. And now we have groups that are starting to arm themselves and make militant chants in the middle of the streets. And we have people that are running black supremacist websites. How is it white supremacy is bad, but black supremacy is okay? Does that not make you a hypocrite?
No, neither are okay, though. That's the point. But it seems that we gotta understand, though. It's like, so when you get angry, you want to fight fire with fire. And I think that that is the case for this black extremist movement. It is fighting fire with the fire of white extremists, and neither are okay. But it's kind of like when you get punched and you punch someone back, you're both wrong, but the person who punched back, maybe that it's more understandable. I'm not saying it's a good idea, but what I am saying is that we need to fix things now. It's getting dangerous, and it's not, you know, a black problem, it's not a white problem, it's everyone's problem. And I think it's largely in part to laws and, you know, regulations put in by your buddy Ronald Reagan. I mean,
there we go. I knew you were going to figure out a way to take the pot shot at Reagan. The dude's dead. Let him sleep.
Ugh, whatever.
I mean, look, no, but seriously, we can keep taking pot shots about how Reagan did this and he should have been more like Carter or he should have done this because, I mean, let's face it, nobody who's conservative is ever going to win in your book. But the simple fact of the matter is, whether you realize it or not, we're saying the exact same thing. We're just saying it differently because there is a problem. The problem is nobody's actually recognizing the cause of the problem. You want to blame the white people and then Ronald Reagan. I want to blame the government as a whole because they've been the ones categorizing us and trying to fit square pegs into round holes for about the last 100 years. Because they know if they can keep us fighting amongst ourselves long enough, we're not going to pay attention to all the crazy crap they're doing. Hence the Iran deal, hence the gun running into Mexico, all of the other things that have happened that nobody's really even bothered to dig into. But the simple fact of the matter is, we've now gotten to the point where this type of stuff is happening on steroids. And I'm telling you, it's by design, because at some point what they want to do is knock America down a few pegs so that somebody has to step in and pick up the pieces. And there's no way at this point, if you really look at all of the things that are going on, all of the racial tension, all the extra division, all of the fact that even the conservatives at this point, the ones that are usually the ones just going about their daily lives and paying their bills, are so mad that they're willing to follow a megalomaniac like Trump? I mean, seriously? Have we really gone that far? And now we have this group that's just as angry on the other side of the spectrum. And at this point, something's gonna happen if we don't make changes. But we've got to shut this thing down because it's almost time for your show.
All right. Sounds good. We'll pick this conversation up at another time. Definitely.
In these uncertain...
Oh, wrong button. There we go.
They say we offer simple answers to complex problems. But perhaps there is a simple answer. Not an easy answer, but simple.
It's gone. common ground.